Hello and a very warm welcome to you all on behalf of the Serbian City Club, and thank you once again for joining our latest Coffee With podcast. Please click on the subscribe, share and like buttons and let your friends and colleagues know about us to help you and others be up to date with the latest interesting interviews we will be bringing your way. Before we start with the interview today, and in case you're not aware, today's event is part of the 16th Serbian Month celebration in the UK, and we at the Serbian City Club are honoured and proud to be part of this very important tradition. I would urge you to have a look at the full programme, as there are many interesting events on offer, both in person and virtual. Today, it is my absolute pleasure that we are again in a position to host Dr. Slobodan Markovich, a full professor and a head of the Center for British Studies of the Faculty of Political Science at the University of Belgrade, and an associate of LSE Ideas, the foreign policy think tank of the London School of Economics and Political Science. Slobodan has very strong connections with the UK and has done tremendous work to strengthen relations between Serbia and the United Kingdom, especially in the fields of education and culture, for which he was awarded an MBE, a Member of the Order of British Empire in Queen's Honours in 2014. The focus of today's discussion and the reason why we wanted Slobodan to speak to us again is that since 2022, he has been the head of the project called Cultural Transfer Europe-Serbia from the 19th to 21st century. All of this demonstrates why Slobodan is the best person and absolute authority to speak about British-Serbian relations, and in this case, focusing on the impact of Anglosphere in Serbia. Dear Slobodan, once again, thank you very much for agreeing to be our guest. Welcome, and we hope that you are going to enjoy the time with us.
Thank you very much, Natasha, and once again, thanks to the Serbian City Club for inviting me for the second time to speak about issues related to the history of Anglo-Serbian, British-Serbian relations.
I would like to start with a project that you have been involved since 2022 that I just mentioned, which is focusing on cultural transfer. Can you explain what is cultural transfer in the context of this specific project, and why did you decide to focus on that specific topic?
Well, cultural transfer is actually a transfer of goods, ideas, concepts, projects, technologies from one area to another. And one of the focuses of European historiography in the last several decades has been European cultural transfer. In other words, how have various microtransfers contributed to the common idea of a common culture, common continent, mainly in the period of modernity, and mainly in the 17th, 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries. As you know, in those early parts of the modern era, Serbia did not exist as an independent state, and that complicates studies of the cultural transfer. This is the logo of the project, Cultural Transfer Europe-Serbia from the 19th to 21st century. It basically analyzes how this transfer happened between approximately the era of Dositej, the moment he visited Paris and London, 1784, 1785, till today. It's a period of 240 years. If we can see the second slide. This is Belgrade. Belgrade in 1849, when Belgrade had about 15,000 people. And if you look at this lithography, you will see that it's still a town which looks very peculiar, has perhaps several, at least two edifices that you can see that look like European edifices of the time. But then if you look at the third slide, Belgrade in 1900, the first electric tram, industry in the background. And if you look how people are dressed in the middle, you will see that they are dressed very much as they were dressed at that time as citizens of Vienna or Budapest or any other European town were dressed. So this tremendous change happened, as you can see from these two pictures, only in several decades. But of course, it didn't affect different areas of Serbia at the same time. And among other things, we have been trying to analyze how various states and their cultures, France, Germany, Italy, Britain, or something that we called Anglosphere, which includes a joint influence of Britain and the United States, indeed influenced Serbia and changed it very dramatically. So we already published three books. The first one is about Dimitri Mitrinovic, another person who connects Britain and Serbia. But in this particular case, it is about cultural transfer that came from Central Europe and from Southeast Europe to Britain, because he gathered one group of very prominent Britons who became his followers in the interwar period in Bloomsbury area. So he was like a kind of a social reformer, guru, combination of all these things. And so and we also tried to understand him in the context of cultural transfer. But then we started with a series of books of cultural transfers. You can see our two books with which we started a series of books, and that will be about five books, hopefully, by the end of this year. So the first one is about cultural transfer, Europe-Serbia, methodological issues and challenges. There are contributions inside of some of the people who you already know, who already had coffee with you, like Vesna Goldsworthy, for instance. Contribution by one of the people, of the scholars who canonized this whole idea, this whole concept for historians of cultural transfer, professor from University of Vienna, Wolfgang Schmale. And the second book, with the second book, we moved to a chronological coverage of various periods, and it is about the 19th century. The second book is was published in Serbian. The third book will be about the transfer Europe from Europe to the Kingdom of Yugoslavia. It is being done now, and we hope that it will come out by the end of this year or in the next year. The fourth book is about the transfer to the socialist Yugoslavia, which will also come out this year. And finally, in June, we plan a conference entitled The Balkan Serbia and Europe. And the focus of that conference will be how did this transfer change Serbia and the region? How did it contribute to the Europeanization of the region in the last two or three centuries? Serious discussion on Europeanization of the region, and as you know, in the context of European integration and the fact that the region is trying to bridge economic gap and also to integrate itself with the rest of Europe, this will be a very important conference. Of course, this is all happening in a post-Brexit era, but to start with that, Britain actually contributed. It may sound a bit peculiar in the post-Brexit era, but actually Britain contributed very significantly to the Europeanization of both Serbia and the region. These are organizations that are included here. Everything is financed by the Science Fund of the Republic of Serbia through a World Bank grant. And finally, the last slide is how we came to the whole idea. We organized one big conference on British-Serbian relations. There were two parts. One was in London and the other one was organized in Belgrade, the Faculty of Political Science. And then we came with this book that was also supported by the British Embassy and was published in Belgrade, but in English. And this is the biggest book until now published on British-Serbian relations. And analyzing these particular relations, we suddenly realized how many ideas, concepts, technologies, constitutional solutions, even things that belong to everyday life, how many literary works, artistic works, were actually influenced by Britain. And that basically prompted us to think, okay, if we now analyze all of European cultures, how they contributed, we would then see how this concept of Europeanization actually tremendously affected and so dramatically changed the region in the previous two centuries.
And, reflecting the historical context and the period that you have reviewed, cultural transfer could be interpreted as Western cultural hegemony. Do you agree with that hypothesis?
Certainly, because the region was economically was lagging behind the West already, what we considered the Western core countries of Western Europe, also German lands. They were significantly more advanced economically, and countries, emerging independent countries of the Balkans, were really trying to modernize themselves, as we say today. They were trying to bring as many ideas, concepts, technologies, and other things from the West that they could. So basically, Western countries exercised that hegemony not only over the Balkans, but over the world at that time.
I mean, what was interesting when you showed those couple of pictures in terms of the clothing that was different, but the Serbian demographic in general was quite interesting during that period. The country was mainly rural with very high illiteracy levels. So the question is, how has that really impacted the cultural transfers?
Well, country was predominantly rural at the time of at the time when Serbia reached got its independence in 1878. Country was almost 90% rural. In 1910, it was 87% rural. In terms of illiteracy, literacy was only 4%, slightly above 4% in 1866. And by 1900, it was 17%. We do not know exactly what was the percentage of literate people before, but judging from some remarks of Vuk Karadžić in the 1820s, among Christians, and these were mostly Christian peasants of the area, still not even an autonomous area, that percentage was significantly below 1%. So to go from that to 17% by 1900 is quite a tremendous improvement, and especially urban literacy rate was going up. So by 1900, urban literacy rate was almost 50%. So although urban areas were not so big. So yes, this was very, very different. Circumstances are very different in comparison with anything that we could imagine today.
And when talking about the UK influence in Serbia, the first name that springs to mind is usually Dositej Obradović, who is probably the first well-known Serbian that spent some time in the UK in the 18th century, as you already mentioned, apart from Paris and other places. From his records, we know that London left an everlasting impression on him. But what are the key things that he brought back to Serbia, and what was actually the lasting visit or influence of that visit on Serbia? And are there any books or authors that had the biggest influence on Dositej's work and Serbia as a whole in that specific period of time?
Well, Dositej's visit really changed a lot of things, and he visited, it was kind of his own grand tour. And up to Dositej, Serbs were looking to the east, either to Kiev, where a theological seminar was, or to and Moscow, or to places of pilgrimage like Mount Athos or Jerusalem. But he totally changed this idea where Serbs should go, what an educated person of enlightenment should do. And his grand tour included German universities, Paris and London. And he described all of that in letters in his autobiography. And in the second part of that autobiography, in letter 11, he described London as the most beautiful and the most glorious town in the world. Because London basically passed tremendous changes in the period 1760-1780. So Dositej witnessed, was able to see it. And it was the major, already the major trade center in the world. So he was totally impressed by it. He speaks with huge admiration of his stay in Britain, of his stay in London. He advised Serbs to read English moral authors, and he quoted some of them. And some of them really influenced him very much, like Joseph Edison and others. Some are less known today than were known in his own time. Generally, the most important message that he sent to the Serbs was that in the Age of Enlightenment, in order for an area, for a group to progress, that group needs to be educated. It needs to reach educational levels that he witnessed in Jena, in Halle, in Paris, in London, and elsewhere. And he, and that surprisingly was accepted by the almost totally illiterate Serbia, because some of his followers among Habsburg Serbs actually moved to Serbia, came there in the 1820s and 1830s. And interestingly enough, the first collected works of any Serb ever published, practically among the first books that were published in autonomous Serbia, were collected works of Dositej Obradović. So from the very beginning of that autonomous principality, Dositej was very much appreciated. And in 1839, the autonomous Serbia accepted the idea that every year 10 persons should be sent, paid by the state, to study abroad, to return in order to reform Serbia. And gradually this number, this annual number of people, of young students who got stipends from the state, grew to 20 to 30. And step by step, this group basically changed Serbia. They were the main bearers of this cultural transfer. And they were not really sent too much to Britain, because Britain was, of course, too far away. They were mostly sent to German lands or Paris or and other areas, Vienna, etc. But this then changed during the First World War, the most famous period in mutual relations. What happened is that those Serbs who studied at all those universities, they were bringing cultural transfers from Britain, even when they studied in Paris or Berlin, because they learned about John Stuart Mill there, And then they wanted to pass the idea on John Stuart Mills. Serbia, even my name, by the way, is just a translation of John Stuart Mill essay on liberty. And one Serbian Anglophile was so much fascinated by John Stuart Mill that he called his son Liberty Man, or Slobodan in Serbian, which was the first such name in 1869. So this is how this transfer actually came, and this is one of the things that we have been analyzing. How did Anglosphere influence Serbia? And it can be implemented to any Balkan country. And why do we speak about Anglosphere? Because very often we cannot distinguish if something came from the United States or from Britain. Some books, first of all, were published at the same time as they are today in Britain or America. Britannica, Encyclopedia Britannica, moved to its headquarters, moved to the United States in honors at some point, etc., etc. So all these things came as a package. Even during the famous Eastern crisis, some of the journalists that actually influenced Gladstone very much to be so much involved were Americans. So that's why we speak about Anglosphere, sphere of English language, which influenced Serbia and the region.
Yeah, and I mean, Dositej was a colossal figure in Serbian history, and the reform that he brought are legendary now. On the other hand, in Serbia, we also had Vuk Stefanović Karadžić, who you also briefly mentioned, who is the earliest Serbian proto-ethnographer and was the author of the first Serbian dictionary, which was published in 1818. Can you tell us a little bit about his significance and who were some of the other major agents of culture transfer in Serbia during that time?
Well, Vuk Karadžić, who, by the way, has an excellent biography in English written by a former British ambassador to socialist Yugoslavia, which is a very, very peculiar case that one of the major biographies was written by a diplomat of another country, and it is, of course, Duncan Wilson's The Life and Times of Vuk Stefanović Karadžić, that were published the book was published in 1970. And Karadžić was one of the main mediators between German cultures and various entities that with the German language, because he, of course, lived in the first half and early years of the second half of the 19th century, so Germany was still not united, but there were many states. And he did something that is very peculiar for a country that and the nation that was only emerging, that had such a tremendous illiteracy rate, and that had nascent institutions. He was able to transfer ideas on that Serbs also had certain level of culture that deserves to be analyzed by people like Jakob Grimm or Goethe or Leopold von Ranke. So some of the major German intellectuals of that time. So he did something that we call counter-transfer, which is very rare. So a lot of German intellectuals in the 1820s were learning Serbian language just in order to be able to read Serbian epic poetry. And that, of course, we should thank Vuk Karadžić, also Jeremy Kopitar and others who participated in this whole cultural event. And of course, the Serbian dictionary, which had translations into German and Latin, tremendously helped this possibility of this transfer. So he was one of the main protagonists, but in terms of the of those groups that brought cultural transfer to Serbia, they include three major groups. The first group are Habsburg Serbs, who were much better educated than on average than ethnic Serbs in Serbia. They had schools, they had gymnasiums in 1790. They had some of them attended the Hungarian and Austrian faculties, and they were swiftly adopted by the state to fill in bureaucratic positions. So they brought this cultural transfer from Austria, from Hungary. Austria-Hungary didn't yet exist. It was the Habsburg Empire. So from the Austrian Empire, which later became Austria-Hungary. Secondly, this so-called plan elite, these hundreds of people, talented students who were sent abroad, when they came back, they brought those ideas. And finally, Belgrade was a border town in which a lot of ethnic groups lived. And it may sound very strange today when the first association for the region is that it actually provides Western Europe with Gastarbeiter. But actually, Gastarbeiter were coming to Serbia at that time. So artisans, workers, miners, all these craftsmen, Serbia didn't have them. They were coming from Saxony, Wittenberg, Hungary, Austria, and to many of them, German was their mother tongue. And they were bringing with themselves their own habits, manners, and some of them were gradually adopted in Serbia. So these three groups actually tremendously changed Serbia during the 19th century, cumulatively.
The project itself also sheds lights on very interesting political point of time, especially between the UK and Serbia, because that's when UK sent the first British consul, George Lloyd Hodges, to Serbia in 1837, which was the time when the official diplomatic relationship between the two countries were established to this date, one of the longest ones, both on British and Serbian side. But that visit by him also had an impact on Serbian-Russian relations. Can you explain what happened there?
Well, as a British historian of Serbian origins, Stephen Pavlovich described it, what happened was that he came during the period of Anglo-Russian rivalry, and it was the climax of that rivalry at the point when Russia was particularly influential in the Ottoman Empire. And since Russia was trying to exert that influence very strongly in Serbia, Prince Miloš opposed Russia because he wanted to basically rule himself. And that's when British consul came. He was supposed to, Serbia was not an independent state, it was just an autonomous province. He was supposed to give letters of the foreign minister to the Belgrade Pasha, but because they couldn't agree on protocol, who would stand, who would sit, he gave it to Prince Miloš, and that's how relations were established. But he soon became very favorite person, very close person to Prince Miloš. And but this all ended with Russian victory, and basically both of them had to leave Serbia, including Prince Miloš. So basically, it's a very interesting instance of an early British influence, and he brought also some manners and habits from Britain to Kragujevac and Serbia of that time. So yes, you're right. It is interesting that those relations were established slightly before than with other European states, and that is what we actually did when we organized this conference. those two conferences in London and Belgrade, they were organized to mark 180 years of mutual relations.
On the other side, and just looking at it from the UK angle, the first pro-Serbian lobby, so to speak, in the UK was established following another visit, this time by Filip Hristić and the wife of Prince Michael Brenović, Julia, which was in 1863. How has that impacted the UK-Serbian relations going forward? And who were the key players on both sides in this pro-lobby?
Well, relations between Serbia and Britain always came to the focus of Britain when there was some crisis in the East. So whether Russia was very strong in the Ottoman Empire, like in the late 1830s, or during the Crimean War, or in the aftermath of the Crimean War in the 1860s. So this was another crisis when Belgrade was bombed by the remaining Turkish garrison that was still stationed in Belgrade in 1862. And then Britain was the most vocal in supporting the Ottoman Empire. So Prince Michael Obradović, who was an enlightened ruler, son of Prince Miloš, he concluded, he knew, and that's very interesting because we have records showing it, he said to people around him, look, in Britain, public opinion is so important. And if you want to influence Britain, you have to influence its public opinion. So let's see what we are going to do. And he sent his wife and Senator Hristić, who would later become the first Serbian minister, to the court of St. James. And they actually were helped in London by Reverend William Denton. And from that moment, there are strong links between Anglo-Catholic stream of the Church of England and the Serbian Church, which were very much established by William Denton. And also some MPs, including Richard Cobden, who was very famous MP at that time. He was Apostle of Free Trade, known by that nickname. But several MPs and William Denton made the first pro-Serbian lobby, published some pamphlets, published some works. And what is important about that lobby didn't really make some tremendous success, but that was the nucleus of what would happen later during the Eastern crisis. From this group, there would be one huge group that would actually change the course of events 15 years later.
As you said, they had the first stab at changing the political or the public opinion of Serbia. But the other person that was quite influential in Serbia and actually swayed the way the British people thought about Serbia was William Ewart Gladstone, most specifically because of the Eastern Question, as you mentioned, and the Bulgarian atrocities that happened. What role did he play and why was it so important to Serbia?
Well, first of all, he was important to Serbia, Montenegro, Bulgaria, and Greece. So basically to all Balkan Christian state. And he did some very important things for all of these states. And the most important one was that he started writing about Christians in the Balkans. And at that time, during the Eastern Crisis, 1875, 1878, something very strange happened in Britain, something unprecedented, actually. The public opinion was divided into two groups. It's very difficult to imagine it for people living in today's Britain, that an event in a faraway village in Bulgaria and a series of subsequent events could have caused such a tremendous focus of the public opinion, but actually it did. People were so bitterly divided, and that's what contemporary sources tell us. That's what British historians who wrote about that tell us, including George Macaulay Trevelyan, one of the greatest historians wrote about this age, that even family members stopped mutual communication depending on which side they took. And basically, British public opinion was divided into Russians and Turks. Russians were supporting Balkan Christians, and Turks were supporting the British Empire and the Ottoman Empire. But of course, they were all Brits. These were just their nicknames. And of course, Gladstone himself was one of the Russians. Strangely enough, because he was a liberal, and liberals were not very much impressed by autocracy. Not only they were not impressed, they were very, very concerned about autocracy in Russia. But Gladstone in particular said, he basically argued that Britain had a moral cause, and its moral cause, its sense of duty in the Balkans, was to help emancipation of the Balkan Christians. So he went that far that when he organized his campaign in 1879 and 1880, the famous Midlothian campaign, he actually used these metaphors of Christians in the Balkans as the basis of his speeches, his addresses. And so when he became prime minister again in 1880, that was hugely celebrated throughout the Balkans. He became one of the most popular statesmen in the world. And a decade later, Čedomilj Mijatović, Serbian minister in London, on several occasions, he wrote in one British journal that if you would need some arbiter, some judge to mediate in the Balkans, it wouldn't be Russian Tsar or anyone else. The only person who had unequivocal sympathies of all these nations was William Ewart Gladstone. And there are also some anecdotes. For instance, the correspondent of the Times saw restaurant Mr. Gladstone in Khrushchevat when he went to Khrushchevat to see the celebration of the 500th anniversary of the Kosovo battle. That is how popular he was, that even people in central Serbia would name restaurants and inns after him. So, yes, he was, of course, very much celebrated. He, of course, had a street in Belgrade in the past. And for similar reasons, he was hailed in Bulgaria, Montenegro, and Greece. And when he died, all these countries, their press was full of obituaries that included eulogies of Gladstone.
You already mentioned John Stuart Mills and the significance or the impact he had on or influence on many of the Anglophiles, but other people as well, and specifically his work on liberty or slobodi in Serbian. And one of the most prominent Serbian Anglophiles, Vladimir Jovanović, as you already mentioned, named his son Slobodan Jovanović, which was the first time that name was actually used in Serbia. But can you tell us a little bit more about both Vladimir and Slobodan, because they both left quite a huge legacy behind them in those relations?
Well, Vladimir Jovanović was after Dositej the next big Anglophile in Serbia, very much influenced by British ideas of liberty, and probably the greatest liberal in Serbia in the 19th century. He wrote some very huge text himself called Political Dictionary, several thousand pages, of which about 900 were published, only the first six letters. But because Britain is both in Cyrillic and in Latin alphabet, the second letter, fortunately, his piece on Britain was published. And it's not really an encyclopedic entry. it's a real study on Britain. So thanks to him, Serbs had study on Britain, its so-called constitutional framework on British administration, the way how Brits live. Already in 1872, he was himself greatly influenced by John Stuart Mill and other British contemporary thinkers. But John Stuart Mill had a dominant place in terms of the spread of liberalism, not only in Serbia, but in the Balkans. Also, socialists used John Stuart Mill to promote suffrage for women. So he was very, very much important in the modernization of Balkan countries in many aspects. Unfortunately, Jovanović couldn't, he didn't later have a big political career anymore. Somehow he remained in the shadow. And his son later, he became one of the most important intellectuals in Serbia during the interwar period. During the Second World War, he was prime minister of the government, Yugoslav government in exile, and is one of the four Serbs who have memorial plaques in London today. But he's also important as someone who wrote articles and books on Britain, British history, British philosophers like Edmund Burke, who wrote about British historians, but also on America and American federalism. So he really transferred this idea of Anglosphere and importance of British and American legal heritage and how it could be reinterpreted in Serbia. And something is very interesting, something that one not so well-known author noticed on the eve of the Second World War, that English was not very much spoken in Serbia. Not too many people went to Britain, etc. But British parliamentarianism was taken as a model for Serbian constitutions very early, and even constitutions of 1888, which is again the Constitution 1903 is its replica. They were based on British model, and from various other records we know that even in 1869, when Serbs themselves enacted the first constitution that was effective. The first one in 1835 never came into force. So this one from 1869 also had British and American influences. So just imagine, we said 1866, 4% of people are literate, but even under such conditions, British and American legal ideas, some of them are already known and are already implemented. So this is really something tremendous. And similar things happen in other Balkan countries like Greece. So the role of Vladimir Ivanovich and his son was very important in this transfer of legal ideas, political philosophy, and knowledge in general about Britain and the United States to Serbia. And even in 1872, in that political dictionary, Vladimir Ivanovich was really writing very, very positively about the United States of America, which was, of course, very rare in that age. Not too many people even knew where that country was, but he was already writing about how important this new world and how important role it's going to play. So yes, their role was very important in the history of liberalism and the history of the transfer of knowledge, ideas, concepts from the Anglosphere to Serbia.
Talking about Anglosphere and Anglophiles, we cannot not mention Čedomilj Mijatović, probably the most prominent Anglophile in Serbia. And we, when we first had a chat a couple of years ago, it was to mark the centenary of his passing and reflect on a tremendous legacy he left behind. Can you do a quick reflection on him at this stage, please?
Well, he was the main mediator, but I always say Čedomilj Mijatović and his British wife, Elodie Lawton. And I don't say it just for the reasons of political correctness. It was noticed even 40 years ago or earlier that the great great act of ingratitude was made to her for not mentioning her huge contribution. She was the first female historian in Serbia. She was one of the main mediators between the two cultures. She published 3 books on Serbia in Britain, and she campaigned very much for humanitarian assistance to Serbia. And in addition, something very important today, she was an abolitionist. She lived in Boston before she returned back to America. So she actually took an active part in the anti-slave movement in the United States and transferred even those some of those ideas to Serbia. Her husband was the first big translator of books from English to Serbian. Again, not only British, but also some American books he translated. Benjamin Franklin's autobiography, for instance. He was the main, he was the first regular correspondent from London, and as a person who, together with Vladimir Jovanović, established political economy, which is another name for economics. He was very knowledgeable, so these articles from London are about London Stock Exchange, world trade. They're very interesting. If they were translated to English, they could even be useful to someone who would like to analyze world trade of that age. So they are really very good, but published in Serbian. He was also someone who was the most important person in diplomatic relations in that age. And if we take Denton and him, we could say that Denton was an unofficial cultural ambassador of Serbia to Britain until he died in 1888. And then from 1889 till his death in 1932, and till the death of his wife previously, 1908, the pair, the Mijatović, and then Čedomilj Mijatović himself, was the cultural ambassador of Serbia. And I said that basically his home was a kind of a small Serbian information point, information center in Britain. Every Serb who visited London would first come to see him and discuss with him what could be done in London, who he or she should meet, etc. So his role in Anglo-Serbian relations was unprecedented. No one played such a role either before or after him. And I called him a Victorian among Serbs. And having in mind this role that he had, the fact that he spent most of his life in London, the fact that he was a great friend of Emmeline Pankhurst, the famous Emmeline Pankhurst, who did such a huge service for female suffrage, that they jointly campaigned for Serbia during the First World War in America and Canada and in Britain, so that he was immersed with some very important circles of British society. I actually thought that it would be very good to have his also memorial plaque in London, and hope that in addition to the four plaques that are already there, Čedomilj Mijatović, and I repeat, his wife, Elodie Lotan Mijatović, would get one as well. And I am very glad that the previous ambassador to London was able to, with the help of the previous British ambassador to Belgrade, and with the help of the owner of the portrait, and of course people of goodwill who financed all of that from who are British or Serbian origin, that portrait of Čedomilj Mijatović is now in the embassy of Serbia. Again, a very important part of cultural transfer made by an Indian painter, and who also painted the British king and emperor, and that now this portrait is in the main hall of the Serbian embassy, so everyone can see it. And I think it has already the Serbian community in Britain got acquainted with it. So the knowledge on him has over the previous several decades, I think, has grown. When I started dealing with him, he was almost totally forgotten.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I'm glad that we had that conversation a couple of years ago, because that kind of started an interest, not just in Serbia, but within the community in the UK. And finally, we have, in a way, kind of made the significant change for him and his wife, as you rightly said, to be remembered again for their immense contribution to the relations between the two countries. But I would now look at the English as a language. You have already alluded to it during the conversation that for a very long period of time, it was actually the least used of all European languages in Serbia. But what was also quite interesting that even among diplomatic service, there were very few people who actually spoke English. So I was just wondering how and why has that changed and when?
Well, first of all, you know, the 18th century is usually called the French century. So at that time, everyone spoke French. Any person who wanted to be something in Europe, of course, spoke French. And then things changed, because what we had after the Napoleonic Wars was Pax Britannica. Whether it started immediately or in the middle of the 19th century, it doesn't matter. It appeared at some point. And this new role of Britain and then Pax Americana later together, they basically gave this huge prominence to the English language that we now know, but it wasn't the case in the early 19th century anywhere. In addition, Belgrade was a border town, as I already mentioned, a border place bordering with the Habsburg Empire, so German was, of course, logically the most important language. You couldn't basically do anything in Belgrade, let's say in the middle of the 19th century, without knowing German. And then gradually the French language took over. So the change really happened. The knowledge of English was very minimal. The first courses on English appeared only in the 1880s by Sir from America, who lived in America. And what really changed everything about the English language was the experience of the First World War, the fact that 500 boys, either as students or as orphans, were accepted wholeheartedly by various British institutions or by various Christian schemes. And then, once they returned back, you suddenly had 500 people enthusiastic about Britain, who really treated with enormous care in Britain, and who naturally enough, almost all became Anglophiles. And in addition to them, a lot of Serbs returned back from America as volunteers and stayed. And then finally, the royal family became connected with British royal family through Queen Maria. British king and emperor basically replaced what used to be in the 19th century the Russian emperor for the dynasty, and he became godfather of at all weddings, baptisms, etc. So all these links then suddenly made English language more and more spoken and resulted in the establishment in the interwar period of the finally of the English language department in Yugoslavia, again run by one of those boys who was in Britain during the First World War. So they really brought this huge change. Finally, even a group of Russian emigrants, because there were tens of thousands of Russian emigrants who came to the Kingdom of Yugoslavia, escaping the Bolshevik Revolution. So many of them spoke English or French, and they became private tutors to Serbs and Yugoslavs, teaching them, among other things, English. So this, again, cumulative influx of Serbs who lived in Britain during the war, Serb Americans, exiled Russians who spoke English, and a lot of Brits who came for commercial or other reasons to Yugoslavia. This all made English language more and more spoken. And then, surprisingly, it was during socialism that English became something you wouldn't expect. But it was the result of Stalin's split with Tito in 1948-49. And after that, American culture became very strong, very influential in Yugoslavia. And with American culture, so we speak again of Anglosphere, it wasn't only American culture, because, of course, all British pop groups were extremely popular in Yugoslavia. So all of this together made English almost the only foreign language spoken in not everywhere, because it had regional patterns, but for instance, in Belgrade in the 1970s or 80s, there was a total dominance of English language among those, among foreign languages that anyone wanted to learn. So you had basically huge change from almost total ignorance about the language to the main foreign language 100 years later.
Yes, well, it was interesting when I went to school in Belgrade, primary and secondary school, we had two foreign languages. English was compulsory, and you had an add-on language, and you either had Russian, German, French, or Italian, depending on which kind of class in the school itself you were given to. So that's quite interesting to reflect on that. But we have been focusing quite a lot on the culture transfer to Serbia. However, there were certain words and types of poetry that were transferred from Serbia to Western Europe during that period as well, even though, as you already mentioned, Serbia did not exist as a separate political entity. Can you let us know what they are?
Well, to start with an anecdote, in addition to the word vampire that was transferred probably from Serbian to European languages, but that was in the 18th century. In the 19th century, there was a huge interest during the era of Romanticism about national poetry, about epic poetry, and Serbian epic poetry was taken as a very important example. This was mainly done through Germany, and there were some also British works that copied German works, but also Ranke's History of Serbia was translated into English and served as the main source of Serbia for many years, until basically William Denton wrote his book in the 1860s. So that was the main counter transfer, and of course it got more and more complicated, and then during socialism you had other forms of transfers into both directions. Some elements of some artistic performances, for instance, etc., were transferred also from Yugoslavia elsewhere, not only to Western countries, to China and other countries as well, but specifically, it took very long time until a country that had such a huge problem with its modernization, with its space with Europe, to produce elite that could cope first with the Western countries and then that could gradually contribute. And speaking of Anglosphere, the American embassy in Serbia actually very much used this fact that engineers of Apollo mission, most of them were actually were American Serbs from various parts, not only from Serbia, from Croatia, Bosnia, Serbia, etc., but were ethnic Serbs. So you start from this position that hardly anyone is literate, even in the middle of the 19th century, and 110 years later, you have leading engineers who work for NASA in an Apollo mission. So this is really a tremendous change. This is also cultural transfer, and is also about Anglosphere. So we are still analyzing, we are still finding various various ways of these transfers. What is very challenging and very complicated is the transfers often do not come directly, but you have something that came, for instance, British or English authors were translated by were translated from German into Serbian, and so we need to analyze it also with ideas, concepts. Some of them are a bit camouflaged, and we need to unpack them and to really see how this route of transfer took place. And sometimes it's very difficult. So this is the challenge of this project.
I guess another area that has impacted that transition from the illiterate country, as you mentioned, to having significant players that have changed or impacted certain other countries in ways that we're not, excuse me, even aware of at the moment, is the fact that during the 19th century, Serbia used to send students to European universities as part of the strategic planned elite process. Can you comment on that as well, especially in the context of Serbia today? Because we have, unfortunately, if I can call it the exodus of very young, talented, but not just young, professional people who are going, but there isn't a plan like what Serbia did in the 19th century for these people to come back. So a lot of the knowledge currently is leaving the country, but isn't necessarily coming back, though that doesn't mean that they're not helping in other ways in kind of transferring that knowledge. So just that kind of parallel between the 19th century Serbia sending the elites and the 21st century Serbia with kind of almost losing that knowledge.
There is a tremendous change, and it may be applied to the whole of the Western Balkans, not only Serbia. In the 19th century, the state was sending students to study abroad. Almost none of them stayed abroad. They all returned. And it is very peculiar with what kind of enthusiasm they wanted to contribute to this modernization, as we call it today. They, of course, didn't use those terms, modernization, Europeanization, etc., but to the advancement of educational level of Serbia, technology, etc. Today, there is depopulation of the region. In Bulgaria, in Serbia, throughout the Western Balkans, tremendous decrease of population is going on there, and demographers predict that it's going to continue. So this is the first element. The second is, of course, that globalization has contributed to the fact that you can now basically opt where you want to. In many cases, not of course in all cases, nothing is ideal, but many people can opt where to go, where to stay, and many actually choose not to stay in the Western Balkans. And this affects even Greece, which is not in the Western Balkans and which has economic levels significantly above other countries. It has impact on Croatia, which is significantly above other countries in terms of GDP per capita. So that is a huge problem for the region. Top specialists have been leaving the region. This is a long-term tendency. It leaves. It has significant consequences. Everyone is aware of that, but basically, for the time being, no cure has been found for that. The only thing that, of course, one can say is that there is a direct connection between the economic level and the level of emigration. And there is this hope that with economic progress, the emigration will be reduced. But as I said, even countries that are significantly ahead of Serbia, like Croatia or particularly Greece, have been experiencing the same problem. So this is a very, very serious problem for the whole region. And this is really very different from the 19th century. And of course, we live in a world in which nation state is just one element. There is nation state and there is the whole globe. And I think that today young generations have increasingly this global perspective. And I don't think that anyone should blame them for having global perspective. What is encouraging is that today you can actually share your time, and there are lot of young people who I met who live in Belgrade but actually teach through Zoom and work for British universities or do some projects, online projects, with British or American companies. So one of the elements of globalization is also this possibility to actually stay in the country where you were born, but actually to still work for a global market. And that perhaps will be beneficial for these countries, but one must take into account that young people have global aspirations and global outlook, and I actually wouldn't really accuse them for that. I think we should be happy that also this tremendous change has happened.
And reflecting on everything we discussed today, how has cultural transfer impacted Serbia?
Well, it totally changed Serbia and the region. It Europeanized the region very significantly during the 19th century. It brought technologies, ideas, concepts, political ideologies, everything there. It brought also a lot of things that are now wrongly attributed as inherent to the as inherent characteristics of the region, but actually came with cultural transfer. One of the most contested things is nationalism, but nationalism actually did not exist in the 18th century Ottoman Empire or in the early 19th century Balkans. It was only existed in very, very small quantities it was basically transferred through cultural transfer to the Balkans. So what I want to say is that cultural transfer brought all things that existed in the West. It brought technologies. It brought also various concepts that the West is not the West is not today proud of. But the main point is it dramatically changed those societies and made them more capable to be integrated with the rest of Europe and the world, and to initiate their own economic growth. Unfortunately, not a single country was able to bridge that gap. Greece at some point was very close to doing it, but no country was able to bridge an inherited economic gap that was very significant already in the mid-19th century. And this whole idea of cultural transfer was that with it, the gap would be bridged in an easier way for various political and other reasons. This continues mainly for political reasons. This did not happen as it was planned. But of course, the idea of all these projects, all these elites that were trained in the West, was to make these countries, to incapacitate them to deal with the complexities of an ever complex, ever more complex contemporary world.
Dear Slobodan, once again, many thanks for your time with us today and the opportunity to learn a bit more about the British-Serbian relations and how both countries influenced the other. We are approaching the 190 years of those relations, which will be in 2027, which is not a small feat, as we mentioned, in the world of diplomatic relations. And we are really lucky to have scholars like yourself who are shedding the light on this really important issue, and also showcasing and making sure that we do not forget, or that we learn about people who made a difference in those relations. I wish you, on behalf of the club, but also personally, a lot of success with all your future endeavours, in particular with the project that you are leading on. And I really like to thank all of the supporters of the club and remind everyone again to click those subscribe and like buttons so that we can reach more people. And just a final reminder to people that this is part of the Serbian Month celebration, and the Serbian Month is and the program itself is in full swing, so there is still time to attend other great events. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Natasha, and thank you very much for bringing back some of these persons from and events and from the history of Anglo-Serbian, Anglo-Balkan relations and making them better known to a wider audience. Thank you very much for that.